Okay, ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, gamers of all ages, it's time to sit down and listen to Ben Tobin talk about his Grand Canyon resources update.
All right, so I know on the schedule it says I'm going to talk about die tracing first, but this is going to be a teaser for die tracing and other stuff that we have going on, and if I run out of time now, we have plenty of time later to talk about more things too. So a lot of stuff going on in the Grand Canyon. Let's see here. So, really, I'm just going to walk through what we've been doing over the last couple of years. All right. So, this is a list of. If I step away from that, can you guys in the back hear me okay? Great. I hate microphones. All right, so, there's a lot going on. For the last year, we focused on a lot of stuff. Die tracing is my life now, and that's mostly what we've been doing. But we have been doing a lot of other stuff, working on our sinkholes, trying to better understand those. We've done a lot of paleontology work. Related to that, we're also doing some photogrammetry, which I'll talk about. And we've started trying to do some bat hibernaculum work in the park as well. And then, of course, the never-ending job of discovering more caves. So, and then kind of from there, I'll talk about what we did this year and then go into stuff that we've done or that we're planning on doing this coming year. So, first, this is mostly a plug for a talk right after lunch. Natalie Jones, one of my interns, is driving down from the canyon this morning. She's been working on understanding sinkholes on the North Rim. A big part of that is working with LIDAR data. She's kind of refined some work that's been done over the last 4 or 5 years. And continually my mind is blown with what we find. A few years ago, Graham Schindel did some work and identified about 4,000 sinkholes based on the LIDAR data. We've gone back to that and looked at it again. At this point, we're up to 7,000 or more sinkholes on the Kaibab Plateau. What that means, what that shows us, come back at one and we'll tell you more. that's on the North Rim. We have the LIDAR data. We're able to do that analysis. It's great on the South Rim. We don't have much information. We know there are sinkholes. We see them as we drive around, as we walk around. But that's all we know. We're in the process of getting more LIDAR data for the rest of the park so we can start doing some of those analyses. And I know I've talked with people in the past, but the plug is still there, ridgewalking. Most of these sinkholes people have not really been to, so, or at least there's not been a concerted effort to systematically document these sinkholes and see what's there. All right, die tracing, again, a plug for this afternoon. We have docked die in the ground, and we've learned things about it. So come back, I think that's three-ish, sometime this afternoon. I'm going to talk about die tracing. So, getting to the fun stuff, I think I have a couple slides in here in multiple ways. So let's see here. Let's get back now. Paleontology, let's start there. So we've had a series of interns over the last few years focus on paleontology. Prior to me arriving at the park, most of it was focused on the surface. And just to give you guys some stats, and this continually blows my mind, the Grand Canyon preserves about a third of Earth's history. And we have a record of life through that third of Earth's history throughout the canyon. Most of that is in the bedrock, it's very old stuff, but in the caves we have more recent stuff. So in the last 10 to 15,000 years, we have records. I think we talked just before the break, they talked about Skull Cave and the camel jaw that was found in there. We find sloths, we find camels, we find American cheetahs, a bunch of extinct species throughout these caves. And they tell us a lot about what was happening in that 10 to 20,000 year ago time period. So in this past year, we slowed down because I lost my cave paleontology intern. She got a real job, even though I told her she wasn't allowed to leave. But we were able to document four paleontology in four caves, and one of the things that she was able to start quantifying was actually the relationship between archaeological resources and some of the paleontology we're seeing. I think she talked about that a little bit last year at the ARA meeting, but we've kind of expanded that, and we're now able to show definitively that a lot of these Native Americans that were placing artifacts in caves were doing so specifically in caves that had specific types of paleontology. She talked about the idea of contagious magic. So basically, they were going to these caves that had these specific resources and providing an offering to that resource as a means of promoting a good hunt or something like that is, you know, the concepts behind why we think that that relationship exists. But I'm happy to talk more about that aside. Let's see, along with that, something else that has happened in the last year that's brought this paleontology to the forefront. In 2009, the Paleontological Protection Resource Protection Act, PRRPA, was signed. As of December 2016, the Park Service regulations were sent out for public comment, and I believe they should be finalized by now and have been signed by the Director of the Park Service. I've not seen the signed copy yet, so I don't know exactly the status of that. But what this act does and the regulations do is provide the type of protection for paleontological resources that we currently see for archaeological resources and for cave resources within national parks. So it really elevates our acceptance of these as valuable resources and provides some backing to that in the legal realm. So going from there, this has been a really fun and difficult project to start. I know there's a handful of people here that have at least been to the Grand Canyon and caved in the Grand Canyon. How many people have tried to get into Grand Canyon caves in the winter? Here, a couple? Yeah, it's fun. It's a challenge. Last year, we went to some caves in the northeast part of the park in the Nankweep Drainage. To access the caves, it was a 3-mile snowshoe up to the rim, and then it was like 3 miles of off-trail hiking through 2 feet of snow, all the way down below the limestone. There was 2 feet of snow down to, for those of you familiar with it, down to the Bright Angel Shale. And then we had to hike around and get up to the caves to look for bats hibernating. So that said, in the last year we were only able to get to 6 caves, and only one of those we found and were able to document hibernating bats. This is one of them. Very nice little Townsends. But that was the only cave that we found bats hibernating in last winter. This year, we've started our surveys again. So far, we have done 2 surveys, and one of those we've identified as a new hibernaculum. So at this point, we have 2 caves that we know of as hibernaculums. And in total, what we've seen is 9 hibernating bats. It's not the most time-effective study, but we are starting to learn something about bat behavior. We do have, at this point, 2 loggers in there, so we're trying to identify when they're arousing from hibernation, how long they're staying in these caves. There's some conflicting, one of the questions right now is, is there actually significant hibernation in the Grand Canyon, or do we see a lot of these species migrating elevationally and making use of available food sources down at the river during time periods, or are we seeing them actually hibernate for the full winter? It's really interesting. There's some recent studies out that have been showing that some bats that are typically assumed to be migratory will actually hibernate for time periods, and so the opposite may occur as well. And we may be seeing some of that here in the canyon. So stay tuned. This year, hopefully, we'll have a lot more information and really be able to understand what's going on with our bats. All right, from there, stepping into our cave survey work. So there is a fair amount that goes on. Our staff is pretty limited. Right now, it is me, and we have one technician that part-time can do cave work. And then we have a series of interns that we are teaching about caves, but that it's a long process to get them to understand caves and the mapping process. But at this point, over this last year, we were able to finish 6 small caves. We have 3 ongoing surveys. In total, we mapped about a mile of passage. The goal this year is to continue on. I'll talk more about that in a minute. But where we get a ton of help from cavers, there's Jason Belinsky from, I guess, the SoCal Grotto, has been working in the canyon now for years and has been really instrumental in expanding our knowledge of caves. So in the last year, they've surveyed about 8 miles, a little bit more than that. They are almost complete with the Falls Cave. I think he went back over Thanksgiving and they mapped 4,000 additional feet. So they're up to about 7.5 miles right now in there. He's working on, this year he did one trip into Double Bobber Cave, which is the longest cave in the park. They didn't map too much, but that cave is well over 28 miles now. And they completed a series of other caves in that area. And it's one of those classic things. They went to this area with the intent of wrapping it up. And sure enough, they found a lot of new stuff. So I'm going to kind of sidestep here before I start talking about stuff we're doing next year. And I thought it would be nice to just kind of walk you guys through some of the stuff they found in the last year. We were really lucky on a lot of Jason's expeditions. He did have a series of really nice cave photographers join the expeditions. So we got a lot of really nice photography. This one is from Steve Eganor, who I guess now is back in Colorado, but used to be an Arizona caver. And this is some of those really long gypsum hairs in Falls Cave. So this is some of the new stuff. The rest of the photos in this section are from a combination of Steve Eganor and Brandon Koalas. Just so you guys know who took the photos, I'm not as good a photographer as either of them. So these are classic red wall caves, very vertical. Some of the vertical work to get into these, I wasn't on the trip, but it's some of the most technical vertical work that I've heard of in the US. The guy that led the climb down into it decided that he's now the world expert on down aid climbing. So there are these big overhanging alcoves and he had to work his way into that alcove as he went down. So again, a classic red wall entrance. And as always seems to be the case with these caves, you have nice little swing-ins to get into the cave. And once you're in there, kind of these are some of my favorite Grand Canyon photos, the entrances looking out with the beautiful red wall in the background. This cave, once you get into it, is spectacular. We have giant passages. The formations are incredible in here. Some of these are things that I've not seen elsewhere. Paul Berger, who's the Alaska regional hydrologist, used to work at Carlsbad, is a pretty solid mineralogist, and he could not identify some of the mineralogy that they're seeing in the cave. So we're seeing lots of gypsum. This area is just full of gypsum hairs and gypsum flowers. This is the stuff that most of it looks like gypsum, but there are quite a few areas, you can definitely see the green on there. It's some sort of inclusion within the mineralogy, so that's actually what you see in the cave. It's not a trick of the light or anything, but we don't know exactly what's causing that. And it's something we've seen in a cave a few years ago. We saw a small patch of it that was maybe a foot in diameter. What they found in this cave was an entire passage where the ceilings and walls were covered with this green gypsum. So, lots of questions. Hopefully we'll be going back and doing a little bit more work in those caves. I've actually been working with a mineralogist to try to get a study going to understand that mineralogy and where those speleothems came from. always have to put this in here to start this year's work. There's so much to do and so few of us doing it in the canyon that it's pretty exhausting. This is Robin, my paleontology intern, who has decided to give up that and go get a real job. I don't understand it, but anyway, so with our staff this year, as I said, we do have myself, we have a part-time technician now. We're hopefully going to be hiring additional technicians. Beyond that, we do have interns that come out for 6 months at a time to help with a lot of the science work that we're doing. We do have currently one graduate student at NAU who is working on Roaring Springs Cave as her master's thesis, and we are looking at getting two additional graduate students started on work in the canyon this year. And then, of course, we have volunteers. We do have some that are long-term. They'll stay at the park for 6 months. And then anyone else that comes in for shorter time periods to help out with trips. So with that said, moving into this year's priorities, diet tracing. I'll talk a lot more about this afternoon, but the diet trace work is a park priority because really what we're trying to do is understand where the park's water supply comes from. So for those of you that haven't heard me talk about this before, our water supply is a karst spring. And so we are trying to better understand water flow in that spring, how it relates to the surface, and what area on the surface is flowing to that spring. And so you guys saw photos of Falls Cave earlier. This is one of our monitoring sites. It's interesting, and I'll leave it at that, what we're seeing with the diet trace. Paleontology, as I said, I lost my cave paleontologist, and at this point, I'm not planning on continuing much paleontology work this year unless we get funding for additional folks. But at the moment, what we're doing is really just wrapping up her work and putting it into manuscripts that we are hopefully going to get out and publish in the next 3 to 6 months. A big part of that is the photogrammetry, which I think I skipped over in my talking, but for those of you that aren't familiar with photogrammetry, it's fantastic. It's a way of 3D modeling anything that you can think of, really, using just photography. So we go to a site. This is one that we've tried to do photogrammetry with. This is a mummified bat hanging on a gypsum curl. What we do is we go to a site, we photograph it, usually 20 to 50 times from all different angles, and then using some of the software we have, that software will compile those photos into a 3D model of whatever the object was that we photographed. If we get the funding for it, we're actually hoping to do this for an entire cave. We have a 100 meter long cave that is ideal for this and may provide a great outreach opportunity for the park to talk about what our cave resources are and what the cave resource issues are. But that's gonna require some additional funding beyond what we have. So I've talked about our sinkholes. That ties into our aquifer system. So obviously sinkholes are the source of water for our springs. Really what we're trying to do is understand how vulnerable our groundwater system is. And there's a series of modeling efforts we can do, and we've done tests on it within the park, but right now we're collaborating with the Kaibab National Forest to expand that to the entire Kaibab Plateau to better understand how vulnerable our aquifer systems are there. And then our survey work. So this year we do have 3 ongoing surveys. Roaring Springs, which is pictured here, that is the park's water supply. We have remapped about 2 miles of that cave, and we have about a third of a mile of resurvey left to do. And beyond that, there's something like 20 leads that don't exist on any previous map, so we have a lot of work left to do there. Stanton's Cave is another one. It's a bat hibernaculum. It's an archaeological site, a paleontological site, and we don't have a good map of that. So we started that, and hopefully we'll finish that this summer. And that last cave is another one of our spring caves that we're working on remapping and inventorying as we go through. I've added other caves on here, so my main interest is our hydrology. Better understanding the hydrology of the Kaibab Plateau is really one of my main goals, so that we can protect our water supply and understand our the future of water there. So Tapeats Cave and Thunder River Cave are both stream caves that we need better inventory and survey data for. And then beyond that, I've talked with Bob about this in the past. Horseshoe Mesa receives a lot of visitation, and we don't have solid inventory or survey data for a lot of the caves on the mesa, so we are going to go back and resurvey some of those caves, and hopefully this year we can start doing some of that work. Let's see, so I think that's pretty much all I have, and feel free to come and talk to me about volunteer opportunities. There's always things that we can come up with. I've already talked with Jim a little bit this morning about potential ridge walking and sinkhole work in the park, so feel free to come and chat with me about that.